Good evening, one and all. On behalf of Rajkot Ophthalmic Society, I would like to welcome you all to this Rajkot Ophthalmic Society case file 7. So today we have two academic cases. One is from Dr. Ashish Pandey. He is a resident in GT Shed PDU Medical College. He will be presenting on mucormycosis cases, case series. And second will be by Dr. Preeti Jain. She will be talking on wide field imaging, retinal imaging. And she is a fellow at Retina Hospital. After that, we will be felicitating our senior ophthalmic surgeon, Dr. Janak Mehta. So with this, I would like to request Dr. Ashish Pandey to share his screen. Thank you. And please all kindly keep yourselves muted.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Thanks, sir. Good evening, everyone. Sir, I would like to thank Rajkot Ophthalmic Society for giving me this to present this case series of rhino-orbital mucormycosis patients, which were treated in GTS GTC Eye Hospital during COVID-19 pandemic. This study is actually aimed to report the clinical profile of patients with rhino-orbital cellular mucormycosis who have been treated at PDU Medical College Rajkot in Gujarat. This was a single center retrospective case series of patients who were diagnosed as rhino-orbital cellular mucormycosis between May to July 2021. It was under the guidance of Dr. Vimal Javyas, professor at Department of Ophthalmology, and he is also my PG teacher. And also, and Dr.
Dr. Ashish is disconnected. Yeah, you are back.
Am I coming?
You'll have to reshare.
Yes. Is it visible, sir? No?
Yes, visible. Please make it full screen.
Yes. Included four patients of rhino-orbital mucormycosis. Their mean age of presentation was 53 years of age. Range was 31.5. My study, all the four patients were females. All of them were having unilateral presentation, and in all those four patients, uncontrolled diabetes mellitus was most common underlying predisposing factor. All these four patients, they presented with proptosis and had a defective vision. CT scan showed paranasal sinus involvement in all four patients. And all the four patients have received a parenteral therapy with liposomal amphotericin B. In rhino-orbital mucormycosis, it's an aggressive, opportunistic, angioinvasive infection that occurs in debilitated patients, particularly individuals having uncontrolled diabetes mellitus associated with ketoacidosis, immunocompromised patients, and renal disease. Healthy persons are rarely affected due to normal containment by phagocytes. The orbit is a site for mucormycosis in about 10% of patients with hematological malignancies. This organism actually has a propensity to invade and occlude vascular lumina, which leads to infarction, resulting in formation of a black eschar. And its spread to intraocular cavity may be rapid and devastating, leading to fatal outcome. The earliest orbital symptom consists of an apical boring pain, and progression is associated with an increased cellulitis and proptosis. In this COVID-19 era, mucormycosis was actually found.
I think there is some issue with the net connection. Yes, you can go ahead.
So it was, yes. So etiology, it was pre-existing diabetes mellitus, new onset COVID-19 hyperglycemia, impaired mucosal immunity with mechanical breach in nasal mucosa, then increase in serum ferritin levels, systemic corticosteroids, nosocomial infections in hospitalized patients, and the tropical Indian climate. Sir, our institute has treated approximately 700 cases of gynorrhoidal mucormycosis during this epidemic, and in almost all the patients we had ophthalmic exam, detailed ophthalmic assessment was done in all the patients, and the intervention was done in patients who required it. Around 47 patients had undergone excitation. This hospital-based retrospective studies analyzed 4 patients. We had just a detailed ocular and systemic history of all the patients were taken. They went under a complete eye examination, including assessment for best-corrected visual acuity, anterior segment evaluation, and fundus examination with binocular indirect ophthalmoscopy, and evaluation for proptosis and ocular movement. And as an MRI brain with orbit and PNS was advised in all patients, so as to confirm what was the extent of the orbital involvement and to plan out the management accordingly. Complete blood count, fasting blood sugar, urine sugar, blood urea and serum creatinine, and diagnosis was finally based on histopathological examination of that biopsy specimen taken from nasal cavity following the diagnostic nasal endoscopy by as suggested by the ENT department. And patients were systemically managed by intravenous injections of amphotericin B, and dose was decided by the medicine department. And so my first patient was, this is the first patient of my case series. This female patient, she was a 58-year-old female patient. She was having a history of COVID-19 positive 1 month before. And she also had a history of being treated with systemic steroid during the treatment for COVID-19. And she was a known case of diabetes mellitus and hypertension since 10 years. So the patient presented with no vision, no PL vision in her left eye. And on examination, she was found to have left eye ptosis with proptosis with a marked chemosis. And there was restriction of ocular movements with a non-reacting pupil. It's a total ophthalmoplegia was present. Then we had done a CT PNS was done. And it was found that there is a bilateral ethmoidal and frontal and sphenoidal sinus involvement was there. And MRI orbit, it showed irregular patchy enhancement of orbital fat along the inferomedial wall of orbit. At that time, since it was an early involvement, so patient was treated with, patient has undergone a functional and endoscopic sinus surgery by ENT department, and we had been giving patient transcutaneous retrobulbar injection of amphotericin B. But our repeat MRI after FES was done, it showed that disease was progressing to involve superior orbital fissure and the orbital apex along with erosion of bony wall. So since it was been progressing and patient's clinical symptoms were also worsening, so ultimately we had planned left eye excentration in the patient. So this was the patient. We had done the excentration of that patient, and this was a post-operative picture of that patient. Currently, sir, this patient is coming to follow up in our OPD, and she is doing better, sir, compared to. This is my second patient. She is a young female, 15-year-old. She was also COVID-19 positive 20 days before, and she was a known case of diabetes mellitus since 4 years and insulin dependent diabetes mellitus. As she presented with a complaint of swelling in her left eye, she was having swelling in upper lid, and along with that there was restriction of ocular movement, slight restriction. Contrast enhanced CT scan was done for nose and paranasal sinus of, along with orbit, and it showed there was a left intraconal soft tissue density enhancement along with mucosal thickening in left etmoidal sinus. So this patient was also immediately taken for a functional endoscopic sinus surgery. And since there was no bony wall erosion found, so we conservatively treated the patient with transcutaneous retrobulbar injection of amphotericin B. Two doses were given to the patient on alternate days, and patient significantly improved. Her eye movement also improved, and there was significant decrease in the patient swelling. So this is my third patient. She was a 52 years old female, again COVID-19 positive, having 10 days back, and she was using steroids. She gave a history of intravenous and systemic steroid being given to her, known case of diabetes and hypertension, and patient was having diabetic ketoacidosis, presented with no vision in her left eye, in right eye. And on presentation, she was having right eye exposure keratitis with total ophthalmoplegia, with ptosis and severe proptosis. CT scan of paranasal sinus with orbit revealed hyperdensity on the maxillary antrum with destruction of all the boundaries of sinus, including the nasal wall, floor of the orbit, and inflammation was extending till orbital apex. So patient was taken for functional endoscopic sinus surgery, and at, and after that, we were treating the patient with retrobulbar amphotericin B injection for 6 doses. Then after 2 to 3 days, sir, we found that patient was worsening in symptoms. So we again planned the patient for a right eye excentration, and patient has undergone this right eye excentration. This is a post-op picture of the patient. And she was a 50-year-old female patient. Again, she was diagnosed with COVID-19 positive and had a history of intravenous systemic steroids, and recently diagnosed diabetes mellitus, known case of hypertension since 5 years, and she was also having diabetic ketoacidosis, presented a vision of no PL in her right eye. There was a restriction of right eye movement with mild chemosis and ocular pain and proptosis. CTPNS revealed changes of pan sinusitis, more on the left side, associated with bony destruction, and there was just inflammatory changes were seen in the surrounding orbital fat tissue in the right eye, with extension till orbital apex. Patient gone and undergone a functional endoscopic sinus surgery for debridement of sinus. And we conservatively treated the patient with 9 doses of amphotericin B given on alternate day. And patient's eye movement were also improved, and overall patient was, this was the post amphotericin B picture of the patient. Swelling was significant, though vision was not restored, but swelling was significantly reduced in the patient, and we could salvage the eye from getting excentrated. Sir, overall, from our, in all our those 700 patients that we have been dealing with in during this COVID and para era, mean age of our presentation was 55 years in those patients where mucormycosis was present, with slight male predilatation. A majority of patients had this following risk factor which predisposed them to mucormycosis. One was uncontrolled diabetes mellitus, which was associated with diabetic ketoacidosis, and they had a history of being recently treated with COVID-19 infection, with a history of supportive oxygen therapy, either by nasal prongs or mask, and there was a non-invasive ventilation, and treated with oral and intravenous steroids. In those patients who did not have a history of any COVID history, they had a history of prolonged high dose of corticosteroids, which was for more than 3 weeks. The most common ocular manifestation of that patient presented in our OPD was a loss of vision with an ocular facial pain and edema associated with ptosis. And around 22% of cases, we had found that patient was presented with proptosis also. Total around 42 patients, they had showed a CNS involvement. Predominantly, the involvement was in the either unilateral or bilateral cavernous sinus. In such patients, it was found that orbital excentration was beneficial in reducing both mortality and disease progression. So even if before an histopathological confirmation was there, if clinical, radiological, and microbiological evidences they support diagnosis of rhinorbital cerebral mucormycosis, and there was an associated disease progression. Then with the proper counseling of the patients and relatives, a decision for orbital excentration was taken so that we could salvage the life of the beaker. This was the staging that came in the IJO article. So, sir, we were dealing the patient. We were dealing the patients as per this guidelines mentioned in the IJO article. With all the three stage three were first stage was involvement of the nasal cavity and second was the paranasal sinus. And stage three was the involvement of orbit. Where third stage 3A was just where middle mild bony erosion was seen in the middle wall of orbit. And stage 3B was diffuse orbital involvement. In both the stages, vision were unaffected. Stage 3C was where we had involvement of orbital apex, superior and inferior orbital fissure with central retinal artery or ophthalmic artery occlusion, and patient had loss of vision. And 3D was the bilateral orbital involvement. So those patients are which have presented in early stage with stage 3A and 3B, where there was a mild erosion of middle wall of orbit, or mild inflammation was present in surrounding orbital fat in the extraconal or intraconal muscle compartment, not extending into orbital apex. We tried to go for a more conservative approach. We gave retrobulbar amphotericin B, 3.5 milligram per ml on alternate day to the patients. And we every alternate day, we used to check patient's ocular movement. And in many patients, it was found that with 4 to 5 doses of amphotericin B, there was marked reduction in the proptosis. Marked and chemosis were greatly reduced. Though in those patients where vision was already lost, we could not salvage the vision of the patient, but to great extent, we could avoid orbital excentration from doing orbital excentration. In those patients where we found that disease has progressed within 72 hours, and it's clinically also and on repeat CT scan of orbit, so we planned orbital excentration. And in those patients, there already advanced disease was there with stage 3C or 3D. And if there was any CNS involvement was present, so we were doing excentration in the patient along with that functional endoscopic sinus surgery. So overall, sir, from it was from my studies, sir, in 4 patients, and what I found was that the main was uncontrolled diabetes mellitus associated with diabetes acidosis. It was a predisposing factor. Occurrence of mucormycosis in the patients of post-COVID-19 and plus the use of high dose of corticosteroids for a long period of time. Thus, use of nasal prongs and use of mask or non-invasive in ventilation, it acted as a source for the fungal spores to get inoculated. And in majority patients who presented with a sudden loss of vision, we were after examination, we found that they had, all of them were having a totally pale disc with a pale retina, mostly either they were having most of them were having a central retinal artery occlusion or a total ophthalmic artery occlusion was there. But in all patients where excentration was done, we had done a lid sparing excentration so that post-operatively patient could go for any cosmetic surgery if he needs. And our criteria for our institute, we took this criteria. Following criteria we have taken to plan a patient for excentration. One was patient having either denies or no perception light in the affected eye, along with there is a marked chemosis with severe proptosis and exposure keratitis, and MRI orbit showing either necrosis of orbital wall, surrounding muscle and soft tissue, or involvement of orbital apex, superior orbital fissure, or any intracranial extensions. So these were some other patients who were actually being treated for rhinorbital cerebral mucormycosis in our setup. And these are some of the far off pictures of patients of among that 47 patients for which we have done the excentration. And this was many patients that we could found that black fungus was present at the apex of the orbit. So we had taken that tissue and sent it for the histopathological examination, and it was found positive for fungal I mean. So that's also.
Thank you, Dr. Ashish. Excellent documentation and collection of data of this rare disease, which we never heard of before.
Yes,
COVID times. We have our oculoplasty specialist, Dr. Bapul Vyas, with us. I would request you to discuss some finer points of the cases as well as mucormycosis in general, and what is the status now, the post or post COVID scenario?
Sure, sir. Currently, sir, at present, sir, most majority of the patients have been discharged. So, after the discharge, we have advised the patient to come on follow-up every 2 weeks. Follow-up, we are advised to the patient after they have been discharged. So, currently, sir, we are having many patients at that time. At the time when they were admitted, we had treated that patient conservatively. So, at that time, there was no disease worsening or progression was seen. So, in follow-up, sir, we are advising what in those patients where we are suspecting that disease is slight progressing, we are advising an MRI orbit with brain again. And if any sort of extension we find to reaching to orbital fissure or orbital apex, yeah, intracranial extension is present. So, we are counseling the patients if they are willing for excentration so that we could prevent the, because it was found that after excentration was being done to great extent, we could prevent the spread of the disease to the intracranial spread of disease could be prevented. So, sir, recently, sir, around 5 to 6 patients, sir, we have, they were just, initially they were treated with amphotericin B, transcutaneous retroval amphotericin B, but we just recently 4 to 5 patients, we have operated for excentration because MRI was suggestive of that disease is spreading to, it was suggestive of involving orbital apex and also extending to cavernous sinus also.
Right. Dr. Bakul Vyas, sir, please give your comments.
In routine cases, how can you diagnose that nowadays there is an active infection is present or there is a necrotic dead tissue?
About necrotic tissue, sir, we are getting, after that MRI orbit has been done, sir, from there only we get a idea whether that extensive tissue necrosis is present or it's just an inflammatory swelling.
But which particular diagnosis in MRI?
Sir, there is any patchy enhancement is present of the surrounding orbital fat or muscle, so we take it as a sign of inflammation. Or on contrast, MRI, if hypodensity is present, hypodense areas are seen, then it is taken as
loss of contrast.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Okay.
We are doing contrast enhanced MRI, sir. We are doing contrast enhanced MRI.
But you had done any orbitotomy in any cases? Not excentration, only orbitotomy.
No, sir. We didn't have done any orbitotomy, sir. We had done excentration only, sir, for this patient.
I had done 4 or 5 cases, and the patient has very good result without excentration. Eyeball preserved. Okay. And after 3-4 months, sometimes just like thysicoli or anophthalmos, mild anophthalmos, moderate to mild, severe anophthalmos is there. And other thing is, with excentration, we are doing a lead sparing excentration.
Yes, sir.
We are not cutting the lead because lead is usually not involved in this case.
Yeah, sir. We also, sir, did the lid sparing only, sir, excentration. We tried to preserve the lid of the patient, sir, so that later on, sir, it could be used if they need for cosmesis.
For cosmetic purpose.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Good. Very good study. Sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Ashish. Really learned some new things from the study. But I wanted to ask, why only 4 cases? You had a lot of them,
I thought. Yeah, sir. Actually, I had a lot of them, sir. But actually, I could try to compile them, sir. But there's a lot of, sir. In many patients, sir, actually, I was not having all the information, sir, regarding the findings. These were some patients, sir, that we had, they had very frequently coming to us for follow-ups. So we had track of these patients.
Yeah, there is a question from Dr. Jansari. Is asking, out of 47 excentrations, which you said, how many were bilateral?
Yes, sir. We didn't have any bilateral excentrations, sir.
No bilateral excentrations.
Sir, all were unilateral. No bilateral excentrations.
Right.
Yes.
Okay. So thank you, Ashish. Nice presentation. Want of time, we'll move on. Suketu.
So our second presentation, Dr. Priti Jain. I would like to request Dr. Priti Jain to share his presentation and start his talk. Start her talk. She will be talking on a wide field retinal imaging.
Yes, your screen is on.
Yes, sir. Dr. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You can make it full screen.
Yes, sir. Usually I do it from above. Right now I'm not able to see.
Is there in the bottom part?
Jesus.
Yes.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. So, very warm good evening to sir, madam, all the luminaries of ophthalmology in Rajkot. Thank you so much, sir and ROS, for making me present on this platform and be part of this wonderful clinical meeting. I'm here to present on small pupil ultra-wide field retinal imaging. So with this visual memory of guys under photo, of course, color photo image, the montage of ETDRS 7 field, let us now see the types of posterior segment imaging. The traditional fundus camera is capable of capturing 30 degrees of the retina. If we do montage with the classical 7 field of ETDRS, suggested by ETDRS study group, we could capture only 75 degrees of the retina. Wide field is anything which is beyond the 30 degrees of the fundus camera. The montage also comes in wide field. And the recommendations from International Wide Field Imaging Study Group in 2019, they clearly defined wide field and ultra wide field. Before 2019, there was no clear cut definition of what is wide field and what is ultra wide field. So they say wide field is any imaging modality which can give you image in single field beyond posterior pole and posterior to ampulla of vertex plane in all the four quadrants. And if the imaging modality can go beyond the ampulla of vertex plane, then it becomes the ultra wide field. The DRCR group claims for any imaging modality to be called as ultra wide field, it has to scan minimum 100 degrees of the retina in single capture. The problem with the usual montage is it requires patient cooperation. Technician has to be good in doing their job. Pupil has to be fully dilated. And dynamic studies cannot reveal what is all happening in the entire retina. So with the ultra-wide field coming in picture, the management of retinal diseases is becoming far better, more precise. The future aims for pan-retinal, an imaging modality which could scan ora to ora in 360 degrees. So why there is so much need and care for wide and ultra-wide field imaging? Because for better management of patients, we need to document it well, we need to plan it well. Sorry. And this is also required, very much required in the medico-legal and telemedicine era. And also for transmission of knowledge to the next upcoming generation, wide field and ultra-wide field gives better documentation of periphery, which was tough to see before. Also, if patient sees what is his present status, what when he is undergoing treatment with us, what all is happening with his eye, and in future, the follow-up results, then patient becomes more comfortable. The trust of the patient on the doctor becomes more. So,
just a second, Preeti. Your audio is not perfect. Can you reconnect it?
Okay. Yes, yes. Yeah. Or sir, shall I switch to?
No. This is better. Right now, it is better. Okay. Yeah.
Okay, sir. So a small pupil, it could be physiological, it could be patient choice and comfort. And many times, it's not uncommon to find a small pupil because of some underlying pathology. And also in VR practice especially, patients are usually on long-term follow-up. And if for in every visit, if we dilate them, then it's quite uncomfortable. There are multiple devices which are able to give us wide, ultra-wide field view, more than 100 degrees. but optos ranked first in giving 200 degrees. It can capture in a single click 82% of the retina, and it can give you not only the color image, but the red pre, green pre, the autofluorescence, the dynamic studies like fluorescein angiogram, ICG angiogram. So it's leading ahead in the list. But apart from this, there are a few things which are better provided by the Herzberg spectralist. It can give you 150 degrees, capturing 63% of the retina. The only problem is the spectralist. This is a contact-based procedure. So for the technician to deal with it, this is an unwieldy instrument, basically. Then from Zeiss, they give us Clarus, which can capture 133 degrees of the retina. And RedCam for pediatric imaging, this can give 130 degrees. Again, being a contact procedure, it's not easy to work with RedCam also. So optos, if we see in detail about optos, basically optos is a non-contact.
Again, your audio has to be set right. Sorry about that.
Okay.
Sir, something is moving. Yeah, better.
Okay, sir. So optos is a non-contact imaging, ultra-wide field imaging modality. It gives you high resolutions of the retina in a single click, capturing 82% 200 degrees, as we mentioned. And it's very fast. Within 0.25 seconds, it gives you the whole scan. So patients with poor fixation ability, like patients with retinal choroidal dystrophy or nystagmus, we are better able to evaluate them. And this, it can do all with a 2 mm pupil. It is based on scanning, confocal scanning laser ophthalmoscopy. It just uses an ellipsoid mirror, and with the help of red and green lasers, it gives you beautiful color images. This is the way we scan with optos in our retina hospital. The patient needs to be positioned not for long because it can do its job in a very small span of time. So as you can see, the ultra-wide field imaging, we are getting color image, we are getting for choroidal pattern to be better seen, we use this green-free image, then the red-free image, which better highlights the retinal vasculature and the inner retinal layers, then the autofluorescence. The other possibilities are angiogram, like fluorescein and ICG and the OCT. Now, how it helps a VR surgeon? So the first thing is retinal detachment, because it gives you the whole view of the retina. You are better able to document the extent of the retina, retinal detachment. If any subretinal band is there, you can nicely see it. You can counsel the patient about it. And whatever changes are occurring in the patient's eye before and after surgery, patient is able to see, you are able to see, you are able to share the knowledge with your colleagues. So as you can see on your screen, this is total retinal detachment, and we are able to see a big horseshoe tear here and multiple breaks and rough areas here. Now, retinal drawing and indirect ophthalmoscopy, they are also important. But problem with retinal drawings is inter-observer variability is there, and periphery cannot be very well documented as it is with the imaging modality. And in the modern era of EMR, to record those diagrams, it's pretty tough. And this is very beautiful superior giant retinal tear. Now, this is the pre-op and the post-op image of a patient with superior bullous retinal detachment. As you can see, it's post-op image, and you can nicely see the good buccal effect, the air bubble, and the varices, and nicely settled retina. This is also pre- and post-op image, and you can see this main break responsible for this temporal retinal detachment, macula partly off, and there were lesions in the attached part also. And after surgery, the break is nicely settling on the buccal. So there are multiple studies which say that it's just working as a third hand for a VR surgeon. It gives you accurate and reproducible assessment of peripheral break when compared with indirect ophthalmoscopy. Amongst us, a very senior phaco surgeon who came to our hospital, and because of optos, this was a serious barrage lesion. This was also done in our hospital, and this was a low contrast lesion, which was picked up by optos, and we were suspicious for this lesion on screen. And then sir indented and did nice barrage for sir. So ultrawide field imaging, as we shared, it's helpful in documentation and also as a very good teaching tool, because the residents and fellows, they can nicely see periphery, which was always unseen and always tough to master. And because they can see, they can search in the patient's eye and they can see what their mentor is doing and the target, the color of the laser and all these parameters. So it becomes easy for the learning curve of the tough VR specialty is reduced because of this ultra-wide field imaging modality. In this, as you can see beautifully, the lattices, the retinal holes, the pigmented paving stone degeneration. Pediatric patients are always tough to manage, be it any specialty. And to see their periphery, it's always challenging. So ultra-wide field imaging is helping in this a lot. And this is the same experience we have in retina hospital. Like a lot of pioneers of ROP, especially retinopathy of prematurity, they have written a lot many articles for this. This is one of our patients who was screened for ROP with the optors. As the vasculature is good, then we are very sure that we don't need to take this patient for examination under anesthesia. We can directly screen with the optors. This is like patient for whom we did peripheral retinal photocoagulation, and nicely we can see that ROP, like it settled with the regressed with the laser treatment. This patient had FEVR, you can see the fractional retinal detachment, the folds, optic disc and macula all dragging. So these patients always had poor fixation. It was difficult to document these patients' retina. Now with optos, it's become easy for us. This was a patient nearly 7 years of age with high IOP, retinal detachment to an eye, and he was very uncooperative. But because of optos, I tried a lot to see this patient in OPD, but he was not at all cooperative. Then just with optos, we could see that he is having RD and plan his management for the other eye too. Now, ultra-wide field imaging in diabetic retinopathy and other vascular disorders is helping a lot, because the most of the ischemic retinopathies, the ischemia is in the mid-periphery and periphery, which we were not able to see well, document well. But with these modalities, now we are better able to see the vasculature. We can zoom the image on the screen and see the abnormal tuft of the vessel. And many times we don't need to do a fluorescein angiogram to label a patient with proliferative diabetic retinopathy, because we have nicely seen. Even in hazy media with vitreous hemorrhage, we can zoom and nicely see this lesion. And we can see macula also, like for regression, the resolution offered by the machine is fantastic. So if we have given injection or if we have done laser, then we can see that how the patient is responding. We can compare the images of the previous and the after treatment images. So doing medical retina also is very nice with this ultra-wide field imaging modality, because you know where you did in the last sitting, where there are areas where you need to cover, for fellows also to learn and improve with their work, and for them to get their mentor opinion, it becomes very easy. As you can see in this patient with dense vitreous hemorrhage inferiorly, if we try to see and we see also with indirect, but the holistic view of the retina is not as that good and grasped by a doctor as it is with the ultra-wide field imaging. Now, in venous occlusion also, as I shared, the main pathology in many or the site of ischemia is the mid-periphery and periphery. So with dynamic studies coming into view, we are better able to manage this patient and save them from the persistent macular edema, vitreous hemorrhage, and the intractable NVG, which has made many eyes go blind, because the periphery was in past never seen nicely, evaluated nicely. In patients with retinal dystrophy, it gives us an opportunity to excellently document these diseases. Now with better evaluation of the layer by layer of the periphery, the pathophysiology of several inherited dystrophies is getting more clarity. Like Stargardt disease, we always used to learn this is a macular disorder. But now we understand with these evaluations in there that it involves periphery also, especially in type 2 and type 3. and it is very useful for diagnosis and monitoring of patients with retinitis pigmentosa, which we see very routinely, regularly in our OPD. With the autofluorescence, we are better able to monitor them. As my previous colleague presented on mucormycosis, so in the COVID era, we had one patient of mucormycosis with bilateral CRU. So just sharing the image of that patient. And so in our experience, the ultraviolet field imaging modality is giving us an opportunity to better document patient present status, what the patient courses with our treatment, and the patient education and counseling is superb with this. I'll just share one example of recently, few days back, one MBBS student came to us and she wanted evaluation without dilatation. She already underwent dilated evaluation elsewhere and she was diagnosed with peripheral lesions, lattices and HST. But she was not convinced because she couldn't see what the doctor is talking about. So she wanted us to see her in small pupil. Then we said, it's small pupil, the optos only can do. Otherwise, it will be tough for us to see you. Then because optos picked up a lesion and then she was convinced and she underwent barrage laser in our hospital. And follow-up evaluation, it's very nice because once for many of the retinal disorders or for many of our patients, every time we don't need to start from day one status. And we need to see how the patient is progressing with our treatment every month or every 15 days like that. So even small people, if you could see and if you could assess this condition and if required, we can dilate anytime. So the trouble of the patient, it goes down because for over a day, he won't be dilated. So it definitely shortens the learning curve of fellows because they are able to see what their mentor is trying to show them. And definitely better planning of intervention is there. And a very usual symptom which we often come across in our OPD is the problem of floaters. So this image nicely demonstrates one of this floater, green floater, though it's small, but it creates a lot of problem for patients. And many times we have observed when we show them that this is the floater which is revolving in your vitreous and casting a shadow, then they are often convinced and they are able to accept this thing. So in conclusion, I'll just say that ultraviolet field imaging has revolutionized the way we document precisely the periphery of retina and has provided new insights into various retinal disorders. With continuing development of ultraviolet field imaging modalities and recent inclusion of OCT, the future may see increased accuracy and efficiency in dealing with peripheral retinal lesions. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Arvish.
Thank you, Dr. Preeti. That was a nice presentation with nice pictures. I now invite Dr. Manoj Bhatt, sir, to discuss what he thinks about ultra-wide field retinal imaging.
Sir, you need to unmute. Unmute yourself.
Okay.
Yes.
First of all, I congratulate. Okay, it's fine.
Yes, sir. Now it's fine.
Yes, sir.
Okay. I congratulate Preeti on an excellent overview of the optos. Yeah, it's definitely future for imaging in ophthalmology. Your machine is having a facility of fluorescein angiography?
No, sir. We are right now not doing angiography, but now we are doing less of angiograms because we zoom the mid periphery and up to 200 degree, and if we take clear image, then at times optos gives you aura to aura. So if you see the abnormal stuff, then many times now we don't do fluorescein angiogram.
So I suppose
the requirement is also going down.
At present in your hospital, it is being used only for the counseling and documentation, right? And of course, for the teaching purpose.
Yes, sir. Teaching purpose and documentation and counseling. And definitely evaluation is far better, sir, because previously, we have observed that many times if we do barrage laser, then patient definitely, it will be tough for patient to go through at times the scleral indentation and all. Kamalti or Baraj, like before patient leaves the campus, he undergoes doctor's evaluation. So it's not uncommon that we again take the patient in the laser room. And in RD assessment also, because if patient had further detachment or something, then they won't cooperate us for retinal drawing. So intra-op, it really helps because at many times it shows us where the tear is. So it becomes easy to manage things.
I think fluorescein angiography documentation is very, very useful because the single most important use of ultra-wide field, I suppose, is in proliferative diabetic retinopathy, because in one go, you can see the whole retina up to 180 degree, where up to 220 degree, where you can see the peripheral capillary non-perfusion area. And in many patients, it so happens that only some areas are involved. So you may get away from doing the total PRP and you can treat only the affected areas and thereby preserving the field of vision. So that is a very, very important indication of using ultra wide field. And I think fluorescein angiography is very important in this. I had one question and doubt that this test is being done with the patient in sitting position, right?
Yes, sir. Basically, we have kept our optos on our table. So patient just need to be for less than a minute to be in a semi-inclined or
okay, that's fine.
Comfortable
that's
position.
Fine.
Yes, sir.
But
yes,
then
sir.
how could you do the patient's this thing in ROP patient?
Yes, sir. For
and
that,
you said,
line,
you
baby,
said
yes, sir. Yes, yes.
You
sir.
Said, so you said that.
Yes,
okay,
sir.
Sorry. Yeah.
Yes, yes. So for that, client baby position is used by all the people who are doing ROP evaluation with doctors. In that, one end supports the head of the child. The technician who is doing that, he will support and be at the other
end. Can you?
I cannot.
You yes, cannot.
Sir.
Sir,
yes, sir.
Your
Am
audio.
I audible, sir?
Yeah.
Yes, sir. So for ROP evaluation, we need to position the child in flying baby position. The technician, one hand will support the head and back, while the other hand will support the chest and chin. And with this, nice images are taken across the globe. Most of the people are screening ROP with optos like this only, flying baby, and the other is modified flying baby position.
I'll appreciate if you send me one clip of that.
We'll
because
yes,
as far
yes,
as
yes.
I know the world over, the gold standard is the retcam and not optos.
Sir, because we were doing with optos, but as I had to present, so I went through that also, and then I could read lots of literature about retcam and optos. And the problem with retcam is that the illumination source, it traverses the cornea and the lens. So if any media opacity is there, it is not a laser-based imaging modality. The first thing is it's not a laser-based imaging modality. Second is that you need to take the child in supine position. So
yeah, that's the most convenient. That's the most convenient position.
Sir. The flying baby position is very convenient. It's not at all a problem.
Supine position, I think, is the most convenient position.
Yes,
true.
Actually,
it is possible with the baby in the supine position. The retcam is always easier to do, but the field and the resolution of the retcam images is way, way less than
yes,
the optos image. Of course, every baby you cannot screen very well with any of the modalities. We have had demos of even retcam and other images for ROP. And to date, we find that this particular modality is probably better than the others.
Great. Very nice. Yeah, very nice, Priti. Congratulations.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
I would invite comments from others if they have any. The small pupil is a big advantage in this particular thing. The minimum size required is 2 millimeter, and it captures, actually it makes no difference if the pupil is 3 millimeter or 8 millimeter in the image.
True.
So that is
true.
Something extraordinary.
Particularly in a patient like which she described, that medical student, and you know, one who is very fussy, who has undergone the examination in various places. You know, some patients want to get back to the work immediately after the examination. Yes. I mean, it's an excellent tool for such people, you know, and there is no doubt. There is no doubt.
Right.
Yeah. Right. First of all, congratulations, Mukesh, on having this tool with you.
Thank you, sir. Just one more plate toy for us. Yes.
Good.
Right, sir. Thank you very much. Suketu.
Yes, sir. So I would like to thank both of the speakers, Dr. Ashish and Dr. Preeti, for their presentation. Now we'll move to our